الحمد لله تعالى نحمده واستعينه واستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا. من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له، واشهد ان سيدنا ونبينا محمدا عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله. اشهد انه بلغ رساله وادى الامانه ونصح للامه فكشف الله به الغمه، فاللهم اجزه عنا خير ما جزيت نبيا عن امته ورسولا عن دعوته ورسالته. اللهم لا تحرمنا اجره ولا تفتنا بعده، واجمع بيننا وبينه يوم القيامة يا رب العالمين. ثم الوصية عباد الله، تقوى الله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. وليخشى الذين لو تركوا من خلفهم ذرية ضعافا خافوا عليهم فليتقوا الله وليقولوا قولا سديدا. وبعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، خير الهدى هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، شر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. ثم أما بعد، أبدأ بحديث حديث أبي مسعود الأنصاري رضي الله عنه قال: جئت حذيفة بن اليمان رضي الله عنه فقلت: يا أبا عبد الله أوصني. حذيفة هو كاتم سر النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، فلا عجب أن يسأله أبو مسعود عن الوصية، لما لا وقد سأله عمر، ونحن نحتاج وصيته اليوم وفي أمس الحاجة إليها. قال له عمر يوما: يا حذيفة، بالله عليك، أسماني لك رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من المنافقين؟ عمر يخشى على نفسه أن يكون رسول الله قد ذكره من رسول الله قد ذكره من المنافقين. والحي لا تؤمن عليه الفتنة. قال أبو مسعود: يا حذيفة أوصني. قال: أوما جاءك اليقين؟ قال: بلى قد جاءني. ونحن نقول: بلى قد جاءنا كتاب الله وسنة رسول الله فيها اليقين. قال حذيفة: فاعلم أن الضلالة شر الضلالة. أن تعرف اليوم ما كنت تنكر بالأمس، وأن تنكر اليوم ما كان معروفا بالأمس. يا أبا مسعود، إياك والتلون، فإن دين الله واحد. The advice that we're going to study today, and I'm going to tell you why I chose this hadith or this advice by حذيفة رضي الله عنه. A matter that happened a few days ago, and many of the brothers and the sisters are aware of. أبو مسعود came to حذيفة رضي الله عنه. He said, يا أبا عبد الله، the kunya of حذيفة. He said, give me an advice. So حذيفة رضي الله عنه said, and listen to this advice from one of the people that رسول الله told him every fitna, every tribulation, every problem, every affliction, everything that will happen from his time to the day of judgment. Hudhayfa knows everything that will happen till the day of judgment, from the fitnah. Even what we're going through nowadays, Hudhayfa has some news about it. Radiallahu anhu. So he's the best to seek advice from. And this is the first lesson. When we want to approach a matter in our life, when we want to discuss an issue, when we want to talk about something that is related to the deen somehow, we must ask a specialist before we go on. In every other field, this is the situation. That when somebody gets sick, they go directly to a doctor. They do not seek help from anyone else. Not because you're going to school. And this is very important. Maybe you might be studying medicine, engineering, law, whatever. With all the respect and the encouragement to do so, to bring the best doctors, the best engineers, and so on and so on. But there's limits in the knowledge of the deen. Not because you got your PhD in so and so, then automatically you get a PhD in religion. That's not the case. Not because you have reached a level of knowledge that Allah has bestowed upon you and blessed you with, automatically you reach the same knowledge in the religion. Even if you read thousands of books without studying with someone or going being certified, then there is no point. So you ask that advice before you approach, because you might think you're doing the right thing. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ تَطَبَّبَ وَلَمْ يُعْلَمْ مِنْهُ طِبٌّ فَقَدْ أَثِمْ. If somebody, the hadith says, if someone practice medicine, even if he is correct, or even if he makes the right judgment, or the right, you know, he tells you what to take, the medication, or the right treatment, even if he does so, Rasulullah said, if a person practiced medicine, and he did not study, he did not become a doctor, he did not go to school, then he commits a sin. So somebody writing medication for you, you take that medication, you're healed. Instead of thanking him, tell him, Jazakallah khair, but don't do it again because you're committing sin. You're not a doctor. Rasulullah says that. Why? Because if you do it once correctly, the second time might be, but the third not going to be correct. The problem might get bigger. Same thing in the religion. When you want to approach a title, a matter to discuss, then it has to be within the shade of the religion. Within the borders of the deen. That's why Abu Mas'ud said to Hudhayfa advice. He said, the true misguidance that people go through is that people are familiar with things that was forbidden at the time, meaning before them. And people are okay with things that it was haram before their time. So either something that was people looked at as evil, Hudhayfa said that will come a time where people will look at the same thing that everyone agreed that it was wrong, and they will say, so what? It's fine. It's normal. He said, this is the true misguidance. And then he says, and then if people start knowing or people start rejecting things that was known at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is the true misguidance. Whatever was halal at the time of Rasulullah, it's still halal now. And whatever was haram at the time of Rasulullah is still haram now. Nothing changed. So Hudhayfa is telling him that in the first century, not 1400 years after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he said to him, he said, Ya Aba Mas'ud, do not be colorful. Exact terminology, do not be colorful. Meaning, do not change. Today, if people do good, you're good. Tomorrow, if people do evil, you're with them. After tomorrow, if people said that the evil was okay, then you say it's okay. Then they come back and they say the evil is evil, then you say it's evil. Don't be colorful, don't be changing. Because the religion of Allah is one. Don't change. The rules don't change.
The practice don't change. The religion of Allah is one. And this is one of the great advice that Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu gave. Why is this matter?
There being this discussion, and the brothers and the sisters are familiar with UC Davis. They're discussing the terms that people are using nowadays to describe certain characteristic, and they're trying to prove with their intention that this is misunderstood, or there's a misconception about the terminology or the meaning or the characteristic that they build the terminology on, which is the wording, the feminine and masculine. What are the definition? And now they are discussing it. Is it realistic? Is it real? So everything that people see as feminine, is it really feminine? So the brothers cannot do it? Or it's only a terminology that is being misused? When we say masculine, it comes from the word muscle. So the strength and the power, is it only for men? Meaning female cannot be described the same way? Opposite. Feminine, some of the characteristic as the definition would give is softness, or crying, or being emotion. Therefore, a brother cannot have emotion, a brother cannot cry, a brother cannot be sensitive. This is the discussion. That's not the problem right now. The first problem that occurred from this discussion is the involvement of a lot of people into the discussion without their understanding of the discussion. First problem. And the ulama said, لو سكت من لا يعلم لسقط الخلاف. لو سكت من لا يعلم لانتهى الخلاف. If the people of ignorance are quiet, then you will not find differences between the scholars. They don't differ. They know how to talk to one another. The only problem happens when you have ignorant people getting involved in the middle. They cause bigger problem. So the ulama says, if those people, the ignorant people, if they stop talking, the problem will be solved. But the problem is they don't stop. So this is the first problem. Never speak about something without having a clear understanding of the matter, of the issue. So understanding the word, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the believers in the Quran with one word that a lot of people nowadays will consider to be masculine, which both definitions are wrong to use.